And my name is René Cornelissen, and I'm a neonatologist from the NICU in Rotterdam, the Netherlands. And I would like to give you a presentation about, of course, antibiotics in neonates and all the way to treating them. But also what's very important, when do we have to stop antibiotics? This is what we all know. A lot of infants are suspected of an early onset infection. And we are treating now about up to 40% of the neonates suspected of this kind of infections. And that's very high. And that's another point is that only 0.5 per thousand infants do have a really proven infection. So there's an enormous overtreatment. And I think we treat about of the numbers needed to treat is between 50 and even over 100. So there's a lot of overtreatment. Well, this is a statement. It doesn't hurt to try, but that's not true. Because antibiotics in neonates do have consequences. First of all, it's the antimicrobial resistance, we all know. And also, antibiotics do have an influence on the developing microbiome in infants. And that does have long-term consequences. But also in premature infants, it results in an increased risk of necrotizing enterocolitis, BPD, but also late onset sepsis. And also long-term consequences are obesity, asthma, celiac, and inflammatory bowel disease. And there's really a good association between that. In the Netherlands, of course, as in other countries, we initiate antibiotics in a lot of infants. And in our country, it's based on a modified NICE guideline. And we treat about 3 to 4% of the term and near-term infants, and it's quite a lot. It's no infection in 75 to 80%. And it's mainly based on a CAP that's low. The number of proven infections is really low. And then we have the remaining group, and that's a group of probable infection. And what's probable infection? That's always a difficult issue. That's when the blood culture is negative, and for example, there's an elevated CAP with a patient that did have symptoms before. And for this group of patients, we did the RAIN study. And that stands for reduction of intravenous antibiotics in neonates, because we would like to send them home and not keep them in the hospital. So in this study, we studied the efficacy and safety of early intravenous to oral antibiotic switch therapy among neonates with a probable bacterial infection. And this has been published 2 years ago. Well, there are a lot of disadvantages at giving antibiotics, and that's what we do for about 5 to 7 days before the study, because it's a problem for the bonding with the mother and child. And well, the children for IV access needs to stay in the hospital, and that for 5 to 7 days, and the starting family cannot start. And the other thing is, of course, staying in a hospital costs a lot of money. So, well, it would be nice to do it another way. Well, we did study in the Netherlands, and I think you recognize the Netherlands, I hope. Well, a lot of hospitals participated in this study because all these hospitals would like to discharge the children as soon as possible. And this study was also performed in COVID-19. We plan to include 510 neonates in 17 hospitals, and that's what we did between February 2018 and June 2021. And sometimes it was a bit difficult to start up a hospital during the COVID-19, but well, we succeeded in the end. Of course, first, before you start with inclusion, you have to need an infant that needs antibiotics for a couple of days. But after 36 till 48 hours, then you can decide whether or not you can include randomize the patients. Then the blood culture needs to be positive, because patients with a positive blood culture were not included. And in most cases, of course, a lot of patients did have clinical symptoms, and all of the included patients did have an elevated CFP or PCT. And after randomization, we had two groups. The first group is treated with an oral suspension of amoxicillin and clavulanic acid. And the other group just stayed in the hospital for IV treatment. And we were thinking about a third group, and it was just stopping antibiotics. Only that was a bit difficult, also for ourselves. But it might have a beautiful solution. Well, there are inclusion criteria, and there are a few of them. Of course, first, the important one is the presence of a probable infection, and that means that there should have been maternal risk factors and or clinical symptoms, elevated inflammatory perimetis, and of course, a negative blood culture. And also postmenstrual age of 35 weeks or more, and they have to be within the first month of life. And of course, a full course of antibiotics required at the discretion of the treating physician. It was just the inclusion criteria, but now comes the next question, because I think these kind of patients, we see a lot of them. Questions. Let's say we have a term infant born with C-section because of fetal distress during labor, and there was a prolonged rupture of the membranes and maternal fever, and after birth, the patient starts grunting, need for high flow in oxygen, and for these reasons, antibiotics were started. And this child recovered completely in 12 hours, and the blood culture remained negative. And I think we see a lot of these patients. And we can only think in these patients of antibiotics. That's the way we are, and that's the way we have been trained in the past. But now the question, at what CRP, at 24 to 36 hours, would you decide to continue antibiotics? And then your lower limit, at 15, 25, 40, any CRP? That's one answer. I think there are more answers, I hope. More than seven. Well, I think the variation is tremendous. Well, I think the second part of this presentation will go a bit about CRP, because we have to do something with this information. Go to the next slide. Well, what were the primary outcomes of this study? First, was the primary reinfection within 28 days after treatment completion. And also a few secondary outcomes that were the adverse events or side effects, and of course also the duration of hospitalization. Now the last question, I think you can answer that question when you think about switch therapy. These are the baseline characteristics. About 60% of the infants were male, 4 to 2 weeks of gestational age, 3,600 gram. And if we look at the pregnant women, 30% had prolonged rupture of the membranes, 45% had maternal fever, and about 30% were suspected of an intrauterine infection requiring antibiotic treatment. And also important, of course, 80% did have clinical symptoms at the onset of infection, if it is an infection. And about 40% required respiratory support. That can be nasal cannula or even CPAP. And here again, the CRP, because that's quite important in this study, because to include a patient, the CRP had to be at least 10. And there's variation whether or not to start to continue treatment also in the Netherlands, of course. And if we look at the zero, this is just at the moment of inclusion, the CRP was low, 4 in the amoxicillin clavulanic acid group and 6 in the IV group. And after 24 hours, the average was 29 and 32. And this is the interquartile range. And what you can see, the Q25, that means 25% of the patients had a CRP of lower than 20 in both groups. And that's the way we behave or misbehave. Well, I'm not sure. If we look at the toleration and completion of the treatment in the group with the oral suspension, oops, something went wrong. So, 97% of the group with the oral suspension completely or fully completed the study, and in the group with the intravenous treatment, 80% completed the treatment intravenously for 7 days. In 20% of the cases, it became difficult to have venous access. In some of these cases, the antibiotics were just stopped at 5 or 7 days, 5 or 6 days. And in a small part of patients, these patients were treated the last days with oral treatment. Well, of course, this is an important conclusion of this study. In the group with the oral suspension, we did have one reinfection, and the same is true for the IV group. This was not a reinfection with a positive blood culture. It was just a patient that came back with clinical symptoms and did have an elevated CRP. These patients were treated intravenously, but there was no reinfection with a positive blood culture. So IV oral switch seems to be non-inferior to a full course of IV treatment for the intention to treat population as well for the per-protocol population. We also look, of course, at the duration of treatments. And in the patients treated for 7 days, intravenously but treated for 7 days, and the group treated with oral suspension, they had to stay in hospital for about 3 days. So they could be discharged really earlier. In both groups, there were some readmissions, and readmissions were, for example, for vomiting, but also hyperbilirubinemia were reasons to be being readmitted in the hospital. We also did have a look at the adverse events, and about 50% in both groups did have any adverse events, and the most prominent adverse events were changes in defecation pattern and a skin rash. But there were no serious adverse events in this study. The conclusion from this study was IV oral antibiotic switch therapy is non-inferior to a full course of intravenous antibiotics in neonates with a probable bacterial infection. And oral antibiotic use is not associated with more short-term adverse events in humans. So you can just do it, and it goes fine. And of course, a reduction of the hospitalization of 3.5 days. So I think this is cost effective. You don't need to do a study. It is just cost effective. And after a publication, you become really famous for a few days. In the middle is Fleur Kay. She was the PhD student and she performed a perfect study. She could not come because she just delivered a baby a few weeks ago. That's the reason she's not here. And this is Gertien Tamper. She's also one of the project leaders of this study. But becoming famous also means that you get a lot of comments. And that's the issue. Well, I think we can discuss about that. Because, well, you all know Keith Barrington, of course. When you do a publication, well, you can expect some comments. And it's always nice to read his comments, really. Because, because the clinical symptoms. What are clinical symptoms of an infection? Well, we really don't know because most of the patients recover within a few hours. And it can also be just being transition. And well, you have to distinguish between really an infection or is it really transition? But that's always difficult. And well, we all know the way we are trained in neonates. If there's something wrong with a neonate, well, you give antibiotics. Well, I think we have to treat the physician. Just give him sedatives. I think that would help. You can also, and also a very nice comment of Keith Barrington, that is, it's raining antibiotics for the rain study. I think it's perfect to say it in this way. But we can also discuss about the value of the blood culture and the value of the inflammatory parameters. I think now the next question comes. In neonates suspected of an early onset infection with a quick recovery under antibiotics, an elevated CRP is considered to be more important than a negative blood culture in making a final decision to continue or stop antibiotics. And just look at yourself, not your neighbor. What would you do? Oh, I see a lot of people disagree. So they don't look at CRP? I think this is a nice point for the discussion later on, I think. Okay, we have 30 answers. I think there are more people over here. But more people disagree about this statement. Ah, well, I expect it just the other way around. So that's nice for the discussion. Okay, let me go to the next slide. I think this is a marvelous article. It was short, but effective. Ending the culture of culture negative sepsis. Or, well, what's the probable infection? Well, we really don't know. The conclusion of this article is really nice. Providers justify treating sterile blood cultures on the basis of 3 incorrect assumptions. And that's the way we are. They are insensitive. Is that true? That I will show that on the next slide. Unreliable after maternal interpartum antibiotic prophylaxis. Is that true? And I think the most important one, inferior to the clinician's own judgment. The doctors always knows it better. Well, if you just look at the blood culture, blood cultures are really very sensitive. And you can really rely on them. But the volume needs to be sufficient. And I think when a blood culture is of 1 milliliter, the probability that a positive culture becomes really positive is nearly 100%. And when the colony count is really low, then the probability gets a bit lower. But most neonates with a sepsis do have a relatively high number of colony-forming units in the blood. So I think when there's a bug in the bloodstream of a neonate, the blood culture will become positive. And I think we can rely on that. Another problem is, well, let's say we have been treating the infant or the mother with antibiotics. Is then the blood culture still reliable? We have to know that in the blood culture bottle, there are resins and that take care of the antibiotics in the blood culture. So even with antibiotics in the bottle, they still can become positive. And in the growth culture without antibiotics, it's 100%. And where there are some antibiotics in the bottle, it's nearly 95%. So even then, it's really reliable to look at the blood culture. But that's not the thing we do. We look at the CRP in many cases. Now, what about CRP? Again, Keith Barrington. And CRPs are crap. And it's not the first time. There are more publications about that. And CRP can also become elevated in wet lung, IRDS, surfactant treatment, meconium aspiration, prolonged rupture of the membrane, asphyxia, and also higher birth weight. And I think this is very interesting. And because when you ask people, what's the normal value of CRP? They always say less than 10. But is that true in neonates? Well, this is a publication of a few years ago, and the majority of people rely on lab results in case of stopping or continuing antibiotics. And not always, nearly not always, the blood culture, because when the blood culture is positive, we all go on. But when the blood culture is negative, in a lot of cases, we will go on with antibiotics when, for example, the CRP is elevated. This is a very important study of the last century by Benitz, and he published an article about two CRPs lower than 10 milligram per liter, and then an infection is very unlikely or unlikely, and then you can stop antibiotics. And there it went wrong. Because we did turn it around. When a CRP is elevated, then there is an infection. And that results in over-treatment, or more children than necessary, continue treatment with antibiotics. Well, what do we know about CRP? Now, what I just said, when it's 2 times low, an infection is unlikely. CRP value undergoes a physiological rise after birth, just like PCT. And then it comes in about 20% of the cases. In normal healthy infants, the CRP becomes higher than 10. And when I had asked the first question, there were a lot of colleagues, they decided to continue antibiotics with a CRP of, for example, 15. And in about 1%, it's higher than 30. But this is in normal, healthy neonates, not the neonate with meconium aspiration syndrome or male aspiration, because that's another situation. And in that category, even more patients do get an elevated CRP. But also it's important to know that that the CRP concentration is significantly higher in neonates born vaginally than the cesarean section. They get more or less crunched during vaginal delivery, and that results in a rise of the CRP. And also, the CRP becomes higher after instrumental delivery than in spontaneous delivery. And that's also an important issue, of course. Recently, two studies have been published. And in these two studies, they stopped using the CRP. And that resulted in very interesting results. Because in a lot of studies, when you use CRP, in about 20% of the infants that started on antibiotics, it will also be continued on antibiotics because of an elevated CRP. In this study, they stopped using a CRP and they did just rely on the blood culture. And sometimes when there were serious doubts, they started to use, or they use sometimes a CRP. Then when it was elevated, they decided to go on with antibiotics. The conclusion was, discontinuation of routine CRP use was not associated with difference in patient outcome and a lower rate of antibiotic administration. So I think it's better to rely on the blood culture. It's always difficult to implement this kind of strategy because when you work in a team, the whole team has to agree with this new way of treating patients. And when it's only 50-50, then you still have a problem. So that costs a lot of time. There's also a part in the American Academy of Pediatrics, and they also mention not to do serial evaluation of inflammatory markers in a well-appearing term infants. So also there you can find it. Well, take home message. Well, I still think that you can do an IV oral switch antibiotic therapy, but then do it in the patients with a real polio infection. Well, the study has not been powered on that, but I still think it's a possibility. What's new? Blood cultures are reliable. And I think this is a very important issue. A full course of antibiotics due to an elevated CRP with a negative blood culture is debatable. Well, I would like to thank a lot of people, patients, their parents, collaborators, the Data Safety Monitoring Board, the Patient Advisory Board, and also the final support, of course. We did get to do the RAIN study. Okay, thank you very much.